Let me maybe at the beginning only hint at this point that Hans Seidel Foundation office here in Belgrade, represented by the head of OSPO office, Mrs. Konstantinovic, and her colleague, Mrs. Jurovic, that we together have organized already in the past time several conferences together, all about European and partly also global issues, about regional and international scope and matters. And today's topic, I think, is very on some current event, so to speak, with some historical background. As we all know, a few days ago, European Union was taking place a parliamentary election, and the general tendency which occurred by this was on the one side some increase of populistic and nationalistic parties, and on the other side some decrease of classic traditional parties, and so to speak also some decrease of Christian democracy and social democracy. And what does this mean? I think, in my opinion, European Union is really on some transition. Europe as whole is in some dynamic process, and this is especially taking place also in the countries of Western Balkan. And so we have today much to analyze and to discuss. And maybe let me add finally that Hans Seidel Foundation's approach was and is always very concretely flexible, requirement-oriented, on requirements, of course, on our local partners. But especially, it is not only technical help, technical support, but much more our cooperation is value-oriented, values, of course, based on Christian democracy, in order to get or to maintain some Europe as unity of justice and right, of freedom, and of course of Christian culture. And so by this I will end my introductory and give the turn already to my partner. Thank you very much.
We didn't have much chance to host professors like Professor Kaiser before, and it is good to know as much as we can about Christian democracy, about its values, about historical perspective of the European People's Party. And I'm here to remind us all that the founding fathers of the European Union belong to Christian democracy. So both, or three of them, let's say, Robert Schuman, Konrad Adenauer, and De Gasperi, they were all Christian Democrats. At that time of foundation of the European Union, as far as I remember, from the books I read, not as I remember, I'm not that old, socialists and communists were against the Union at that time, and only later on they changed their opinion. So the present Union, as we know it now, it was founded by Christian democracy. Christian democracy today, that will be also discussed here. Yes, you rightly said we just followed the results of the elections for the European Parliament, and the European People's Party has lost some seats, 56 seats when we compare it to 2014, but it's still the strongest group in the European Parliament, which will have a decisive influence on the formation of the Commission and Council and all other bodies within the European Union. So with that, I will end, and I will ask Professor Djurković to take the floor.
I'm really honored to be with you today and to be able to really welcome on behalf of all of us our guest for these 3 days, actually. And I really do have to thank Hans Eider Stiftung for facilitating the whole this event, of course, for being interested and kind to really support us and to help us to provide a possibility to organize this small tour within 2.5 days, which really, at least I personally profited yesterday very much by having a chance to spend the whole day with our colleague Wolfram Kaiser. Today we have a lecture, as well quite a lot of media appearances, which I find very good, because we really do not have too often possibility to have people of this, let me say, academic excellency. Tomorrow we will have a visit to Ms. Our colleague and chief negotiator of Serbian negotiation team for European integration, Dr. Tanja Miščević. Tomorrow, unfortunately, Wolfram is leaving. I hope that this will stay as the first, but not the last, visit, and this is the beginning of maybe some interesting cooperation in the future. I will try just briefly to present him, and it is really very hard, and I'm not exaggerating when I said, according to my, how should I say, a small and modest estimation, this is really, at the moment, one of the top figures in contemporary European humanities and social sciences. It's really very hard to briefly present somebody whose basic CV is written in 31 pages, and it's not being updated recently, as far as I noticed. Professor Kaiser is somebody who is working at Portsmouth University in Britain, UK, I'm sorry, since 2000, actually, and living basically in his native Düsseldorf, cooperating with the European Institute in Florence, but in his career he has collaborated with, I think, almost all the most important academic places in contemporary Europe, and also in Bundestag, in European Commission, and many also very practical important places for understanding European integration and the way European politics function nowadays. I will leave aside all other data and try really concentrate on his books. And his opus is really, I think, one of the, at least for me, it was the most important way to understand the history of European integration, enlargement, and especially Christian democracy and phenomenon of Christian democracy, which Susan already spoke about. Let me just briefly mention at least 10 of those monographs or collection of works. Some of them are hopefully... four of them are present within a library of political Faculty of Political Sciences in Belgrade and in our National Library, and Professor Kaiser was very good and willing to offer us possibility to send a couple of more of his books, so we could provide especially to PhD students and people interested in the history of European integration and Christian democracy possibility to really get more knowledge upon that. So just briefly, Christian democracy and the origins of European Union from 2007, which is really classic in this field. Then two interesting projects for 2014, writing the rules for Europe about the lobbies, about the social groups that are trying to defend their cause or to push their agenda within EU, with Professor Schott. Then exhibiting Europe in museums, one very interesting topic Professor Kaiser spoke yesterday, with Hirsch Kohler, Krankenhagen and Pelz. Then European Union enlargement, a comparative history, written with Elbert in 2004. Two really classics within the field of political Catholicism and Christian democracy, first written and published both in 2004, Political Catholicism in Europe, 1918 to 1945, Volume 1, with Helmut Wonuth. And the second volume, Christian Democracy in Europe since 1945, with Michael Geller. Then, of course, the very important book with Christopher Clark, whom people know today as one of the most influential historians, but also on his book from 2014 about moonwalkers that's been translated into our language as well. It is Culture Wars, Secular Catholic Conflict in 19th Century Europe. And let me just finish with Using Europe, Abusing the Europeans, Britain in European Integration, 1945-1963, which was published in 1997. Yesterday's lecture in Matica Srpska was about transnational democracy in post-war Europe, and for today we specifically asked for Professor Kaiser to concentrate on the history of Christian democracy. So the lecture, the title of the lecture is Christian Democracy in Europe, the European People's Party as a Political Force in the Cold War. And without you taking the time, I will really ask Professor Kaiser to take the floor and to give us a presentation, after which we will have possibility for a debate.
I'm really very happy to be here because I've never been to Serbia before, and this is largely not to do with any aversion or prejudice. I was asked by one of the journalists, what was your prejudice before you came? Apparently, well, you have to have a prejudice against Serbia. I didn't have one. I'm really very happy to be here in Serbia and to be able at least to see some of it and to talk to many people here from diverse backgrounds. And I would like, therefore, to thank all the three organizers of today's event, the Hans-Seidel Stiftung, the Institute for European Studies, and also the Serbian European Movement for having brought me over from the UK and Germany and Northwestern Europe. One of the reasons why I thought this was going to be interesting for me is precisely that I still think that not just in terms of academic research and research networks and topics of research, but also I think more generally in societal terms, we still have a big disconnect. There's not just one disconnect, but there is certainly one between Northwestern Europe, which of course academically is also quite central in many ways to research about Europe and also about the European Union as well, and Southeastern Europe, especially when it's outside of the European Union. I think there are many different ways of conceptualizing European issues, of thinking about them and of making judgments about them, and I think it's important to have a dialogue about these issues. So I would see my presentation today, which mainly focuses on these historical aspects during the Cold War, as hopefully a contribution to fostering this kind of dialogue, and in the question and answer or discussion session, of course, we can talk about much more contemporary issues as well. I would invite you to do that if that's something that you're more interested in doing. The political parties of the left should comprehensively have won the first free elections in Western Europe in 1944-45, after the experience of fascism and national socialism, as well as conservative and Catholic nationalist collaboration, as in the case of Vichy France, for example. After all, even in the unoccupied United Kingdom, the Labour Party defeated the conservative wartime leader Winston Churchill in the general election in July 1945 to win a parliamentary majority for the first time ever. It was not to be, however. The left's relative electoral failure to gain majority support in free elections after the war was to preoccupy historian sympathizers for a long time. Mirroring the debate about the fate of the German Reich after 1918-19, they tended to argue that the socialists should have dedicated themselves to far more revolutionary change of the social and political institutions and socio-economic policy making to achieve a more decisive break with the past. Instead of the Social Democrats, the socialists and communists, the more centrist and center-right Christian Democrats became the strongest electoral force in continental Western Europe after 1945. They revived interwar political party traditions, largely untainted by collusion with fascism, as in the case of Luxembourg, Belgium, and the Netherlands, or they created new formally non-confessional or interconfessional parties, as in the case of France, Italy, and West Germany. At the time of the negotiation of the Treaty of Paris in the early 1950s that resulted in the creation of the European Coal and Steel Community, the ECSC, the Christian Democrats were in fact in power in all of these six founding member states, together with the Labour Party in the Netherlands,
temporarily ruling with an absolute majority in Belgium and leading coalition governments as far away, largest single party in all of the other countries. They continue to dominate continental West European politics as well as the politics of European integration well into the 1960s with legacies that reach up to the present day. The emerging Cold War greatly facilitated the rise and political hegemony of these parties. After all, pronounced anti-communism had characterized both political Catholicism and more secular conservative political tendencies since Marx first advocated socialist class struggle and revolution in the middle of the 19th century. Conveniently for the Christian Democrats, the Cold War greatly simplified ideological and political choices once more. This time between parliamentary democracy and private ownership in a predominantly market economy on the one hand, and class dictatorship and centrally planned collectivized production on the other. Aligning themselves strongly with the United States as the protector of Western Europe's democracies, the Christian Democrats successfully presented themselves as the only effective bulwark against Bolshevism externally as well as internally in France and Italy, where the communists did very well in free elections, with the socialists initially allying themselves with them in Italy, and in West Germany in opposition to the newly formed East German communist state, effectively set up and protected by the Soviet Union. The Cold War alone does not sufficiently explain the durability and adaptability of center-right political parties in Western Europe after 1945, however. As Martin Conway has pointed out, key tenets of political Catholicism remained quite stable from the interwar period into the 1960s. It retained a fortress mentality until the death of Pope Pius XII in 1958 and to some extent beyond. Crucially, however, political Catholicism still succeeded better at escaping the confessional political ghetto of practicing Catholics than the socialists did at overcoming class barriers. As a result, it was able to ally itself increasingly with liberal and moderate conservative political forces, as in the Netherlands, where the two traditional Protestant political parties initially continued to exist alongside the Catholic People's Party, and in West Germany, where the new Christian Democratic parties overcame the center party's confessional limitations. After 1945, the Christian Democrats developed a political vocabulary of human dignity, individual freedom, social rights, and subsidiarity that loosely drew on a combination of personalism and Catholic social teaching. At the same time, the Christian Democrats built bridges to liberal concepts of political pluralism, private enterprise, and market economy, or social market economy, as it was termed in the German case. This in turn allowed the creation of broad center-right political groupings, as in the case of the West German Christian Democratic Union and its Bavarian sister party, the Christian Social Union, and the Italian Democrazia Cristiana. The party's evolving doctrines and programs were adapted to specific national contexts, traditions, and structures of party competition. However, all Christian Democratic parties sought to connect Christian values with secular political causes. They also advocated different versions of a socio-economic third way. Depending on national circumstances, their programmatic preferences could flexibly be made compatible with diverse economic policies, from indicative planning in France to ordo-liberal competition policy in West Germany. With their pronounced anti-communism, advocacy of a third way for European societies, and middle-of-the-road policies in government, the Christian Democrats shaped the post-war consensus about the developing welfare state to a large degree. Their European ambitions were designed to sustain these programmatic preferences. They also developed a life of their own, with the Christian Democrats adopting strong advocacy of European integration as one of their core ideological and programmatic tenets after 1945. They strongly influenced many core features of the present-day European Union, something that is frequently ill understood in East Central and Southeastern Europe, where Christian democracy either never took hold, even in strongly Catholic countries like Poland, or where different confessional traditions prevented it from taking root, like in Orthodox Serbia. With my lecture, I hope to contribute to such a better understanding of the role of Christian democracy in the EU in historical perspective. While I have published a lot on these parties' transnational cooperation at the party level, today I wish to concentrate on their parliamentary cooperation during the Cold War and its lingering legacy up to the European Parliament elections last Sunday. Crucially, the Christian Democratic Group, which has called itself and still calls itself the European People's Party Group since 1976, was the largest group in the European Parliament until 1975 and again from 1999 onwards, and despite the losses that you've referred to in the elections on Sunday, is still by a significant margin the largest group in the European Parliament. In the first section, I will discuss the CDEPP group's changing composition and internal governance over time. While the group grew in size and the administration became professionalized, key practices at least initially survived the first direct elections in 1979, such as the very close cooperation between the German and Italian Christian Democrats. The second section then addresses the group's evolving relations with other political parties within the European Parliament. I will show why and how the Christian Democrats laid the groundwork for becoming the largest and most influential group in the European Parliament again, and how it cooperated with other groups in the Parliament, especially with the Socialists. The third and fourth sections are devoted to the EPP group's European ambitions for shaping two crucial functions of the European Parliament, system building and policy making. During the Cold War, the group's greatest contribution to European integration was arguably its consistent approach to system building based on its broadly federalist agenda and quite united approach to making the European communities and now European Union institutions both more efficient and more democratic. The latter primarily, making it more democratic, primarily by working towards a significant strengthening of the European Parliament's role and powers, broadly in line with the national template of parliamentary democracy. In contrast, regarding socio-economic policy issues that lay at the heart of European integration in the European communities, the EPP group was generally more heterogeneous than the Socialists. In conclusion, I will try to draw out some larger questions of continuity and discontinuity across the first direct elections in 1979. In doing so, the conclusion also pinpoints some of the CD-EPP group's core structural and policy challenges that continue to inform its later parliamentary organization and actions up to the present day. The EPP group was constituted of its MEPs from six member states until 1973, seven of then nine member states until 1981, and eight of then 10 member states until 1986. Until 1973, and again when the Spanish Partido Popular and then the British Conservatives joined in 1992, until 2009, the EPP group had members from all ECEU states. In 1958, the group had 67 of 142 delegated MEPs, the MPs from national parliaments, with 38 socialists, 35 liberals. Between the 1973 Northern Enlargement and the 1979 European Parliament elections, it only had 52 of 189 MEPs with the socialists on 66, surpassing them for the first time. The EPP group's relative decline was due in large measure to the electoral decline of Christian Democratic parties in the Benelux countries and the fact that it had no MEPs from the United Kingdom and Denmark. The EPP parties did well in the first direct elections in 1979. However, they gained the largest percentage of the popular vote and ended up with 107 MEPs of 410, only marginally behind the Socialists on 113. Throughout the 1980s, the gap with the Socialists widened significantly again, however. The group was characterized by two key features which impacted directly on the internal dynamics. The first concerned the low representation of French parties, which resulted from the Fifth Republic majoritarian voting system and the decline and subsequent dissolution of the French Christian Democrats in the 1960s. The low French representation and influence meant that in contrast to the great importance of bilateral Franco-German cooperation in multilateral party networks in the early post-war period, and also, of course, at the governmental level, the CDEPP group could do very little to support Franco-German coordination at this governmental level later on. The second key feature was the strong representation of the Italian DC. This was only in part down to its electoral strength. Additionally, the DC profited heavily from the pro-Western centrist party's decision in Italy to exclude the neo-fascists initially, as well as the communists and even the socialists until 1956, from the Italian representation in European parliamentary assemblies. Resulting from the DC's anti-communist policy, the Italians, with 18 of 38 members, nearly had an absolute majority in the CD group in the European Coal and Steel Community's Common Assembly. After the first direct elections in 1979, the 42 German CDU-CSU MEPs constituted 40% in the EPP group, and the Italians, with 30 members, 28%. So together they actually had 68, more than two-thirds of the membership of the group. Against this background, the CDU group initially developed an informal tripartite relationship between the Italian, German, and Benelux groups of MEPs, which strongly influenced its internal governance. The group's working patterns were also characterized by a strong bilateralism between the Germans and Italians, who together formed a numerical majority, which could greatly facilitate internal policy making. This bilateralism became increasingly pronounced during the long reign of Egon Klepsch as chair of the EPP group from 1977 to 82 and again from 84 to 92. As early as November 1975, Klepsch wrote to the CDU leader Helmut Kohl that one should aim to make close informal cooperation between the German and Italian parties before any meeting of the CD group or the European Union of Christian Democrats a habitual regular practice to facilitate policy making. Transcending nationality, the members of the CDEPP group were largely united in their strong support for further integration. The CD parties did initially face internal skepticism or opposition against their strong preference for a spatially limited core Europe without the United Kingdom, based around the creation of a common market and the dismantling of trade barriers. By the late 1950s, however, such forms of internal dissent were marginal to the point of extinction in most Christian democratic parties, creating a climate that was highly conducive to strong support for the further deepening of integration in the direction of what in the treaty was called ever closer union. Thus, the most pro-integration politicians, who often had formal or informal links with federalist organizations, frequently became members of the European Parliament. Their shared European integration ideology acted as strong glue to help the EPP group transcend internal, transnational, social, political, and cultural divides. These divides included the latent tensions between Christian trade unionists and MEPs close to industry, and especially the farming lobby, which was extremely well organized within the group and integrated into the policy community that developed and defended the common agricultural policy in the European communities. Their shared European ideology also made it easier for the group to ignore the Nazi past of several German members who were, in fact, at the forefront of propagating federalist solutions for the EC after the war. They even included Hans Furler, the European Parliament president from 1960 to 62, or to give you another example, Hans-Edgar Jahn, who had become a Nazi party member as early as 1932. The internal composition of the EPP group made it necessary to strike a delicate balance in the allocation of posts. Until the 1980s, this balance largely reflected the interests of the German, Italian, and Benelux delegations, with some scraps left over for the Irish Fine Gael members after 1973 and the Greek New Democracy MEPs after 1981. Giving the EPP group a permanent and professional operational structure at the political and administrative levels after 1979 constituted a crucial internal precondition for effective policy formation and decision making. This in turn proved essential for the rising voting cohesion in the group, which has been observed in the political science literature about the EP after 1979. Interestingly, this happened at a time when the EP had no legislative powers yet and thus lacked one key institutional incentive for a high level of integration and voting cohesion. Almost as important as the EPP group's structural professionalization were its leadership and informal cooperation and decision-making culture and practices. These were also strongly shaped in the transition from the delegated to the directly elected European Parliament by Klepsch and the Italian Secretary General Betamio. As Betamio has recalled, In Brussels, people said that we were a good team. Egon was the most Italian of Germans, and I was the most German of the Italians. Building on the new structures, Klepsch proved to be a very clever, I quote, very clever manager of crises and opinion formation in the group, unquote, as Thomas Janssen has remembered, who as EPP Secretary General worked closely with Klepsch during the 1980s and early 1990s. Klepsch was perceived as Italian, mainly in the sense that he seemed to understand the finesses of group and EP politics even better than many Italian MEPs who should have known them from their own national political system and DC party experience. Klepsch had a fine sense for the crucial importance of close cooperation between the German and Italian delegations. Despite important long-term continuities, as in the form of close cooperation between the German and Italians in the EPP group, the 1979 direct elections also marked major change in terms of its internal organization and working practices. To begin with, the group roughly doubled in size, and the vast majority of its members already were or soon became exclusively members of the European Parliament due to the end of the so-called dual mandate. To translate the widespread desire among the EPP MEPs for greater internal cohesion and increased influence in the European Parliament and beyond into practical politics required entrepreneurial leadership, however, that carefully took into account the group's political and cultural heterogeneity. Klepsch and Betamio in particular provided this leadership in the transition from the delegated to the directly elected EP, thus preparing the EPP group for cooperation and competition in the European Parliament in the fight over positions, influence and the future of European integration more generally. The dual functional need for increasing the group's size and voting power and making it central to European Parliament politics and policy making clashed with concerns about a potential German hegemonic role. This is already in the 1970s and 80s. After all, Kohl had already pushed hard for the creation of the European People's Party as an organization of parties in 1976 to create a broader center-right alliance in West European politics in the image of the CDU as a People's Party. Alongside concerns about an ideological shift to the right, other member parties also feared that the creation of the EPP in this form could foster German dominance in the new organization, accentuated further by the financial prowess of the CDU-CSU and also its associated Konrad Adenauer and Hans Seidel foundations. During the time of Kohl's leadership of the CDU, he and Klepsch were very sensitive to the resulting fears about German hegemony in the EPP group and party organization. During the 1980s, this continued sensitive approach guaranteed that the strong functional incentives for increasing the EPP group's size and effectiveness in forming cross-party alliances overrode residual concerns about possible German hegemony more easily than in the EPP as a party organization, where this created more problems. These functional incentives to maximize power and policy influence exercised considerable pressure on the EPP group and its leadership, not just to increase its internal integration and voting cohesion, but also in the first place to increase its size. Throughout the 1980s, the EPP group's greatest strategic challenge remained not having any member from the United Kingdom as one of four EC countries with equal representation in the EP at the time. Eventually, the British Tories accepted an associated status in the group in 1992. The EC Southern enlargement constituted a different but similarly difficult challenge for the EPP group. The integration of, in this sequence, the Greek, Spanish, UK and Portuguese parties between 1981 and 1996 clearly marked a shift to the right within the originally much more centrist EPP group. Crucially, the group's simultaneous turn towards closer cross-party cooperation with the socialists after 1984, and especially after 1989, when the two groups began to operate an informal grand coalition, and from then onwards until last Sunday, always had a majority together in the European Parliament. This shift towards closer cooperation with the socialists in the second half of the 1980s assuaged concerns among the Benelux and Italian parties and MEPs about the effects of its enlargement on the group's programmatic orientation. Neither the socialists nor the EPP group could rely on stable alternative coalition arrangements in the medium term. The process of rapprochement between the two largest groups after 1984 was additionally facilitated by the fact that both had large German contingents. These German MEPs largely agreed on the EC's institutional deepening. They also were also keen to overcome the previous ideological polarization from the times when Kohl had used the election slogan freedom or socialism in the 1976 German elections. The influence of the German contingents was symbolized by the simultaneous group leadership between 84 and 89 of Rudi Arndt, who was very close to Willy Brandt, the leader of the Socialist International and former German, West German Chancellor, and Klepsch during this five-year term, the second term of the parliament, 84 to 89, who worked closely together. In the EP, they were known as the two big Germans. Through its enlargement and grand coalition cooperation with the socialists, the EPP group succeeded in becoming the key power broker in the European Parliament. Governing without or against the EPP group eventually became practically impossible until the EP elections a few days ago, and that's perhaps something that we can discuss in a minute. The EPP group's professionalization after 1979 and its strategic focus on its own enlargement and buttressing its role in the parliament contributed greatly to making it central to the EP system-building function. Demanding and facilitating the EC's institutional deepening, including endowing the EP with greater budgetary and legislative powers. For the EPP group, the end point of the process of constitutionalizing the European communities was a European parliamentary system in which the European Parliament would, grosso modo, have the same powers and fulfill the same functions as national parliaments did in the member states. The EPP group played an outstanding role in promoting treaty reform for constitutionalizing the EC. In part, it assumed this role by default, as has already been mentioned, the socialists were for a long time disunited on the issue of the constitutional future of European integration. At the same time, however, the Christian Democrats had played such a role in the debate about and the practical politics of European integration from the very beginning. A role that it cultivated as a core component of its own remembrance discourse. The EPP group's habitual references, and you made this reference too, interestingly, to the post-war political heritage of Schumann, Adenauer, and de Gasperi constituted a distinctly Christian democratic version of the founding father narrative. And this narrative served as a kind of discursive glue, if you like, to paper over the group's pronounced heterogeneity on socioeconomic issues, socialize new member parties into its pro-integration consensus, and also attract electoral support in times of strong permissive, what was called in those days, permissive consensus on the desirability of further integration. The group created a strong vector from post-war party networks and existing constitutional blueprints to the failed European political community and beyond. It continued to play the role of a federalist engine in European Christian democracy after the creation of the EEC. Upon being elected as European Parliament President in April 1960, for example, the already mentioned Furla warned against overbearing bureaucracies that could develop technocratic lives of their own. Instead, it was essential, to hear the heartbeat of politics, unquote, in European integration. Whereas the French President de Gaulle wanted to hear this heartbeat in national capitals only, the CD group advocated European-level parliamentarization as the key component of what the CD group leader Alfred Bertrand from Belgium in the mid-1970s termed the Christian Democrat strategy for the European community's fundamental democratization. The group continued to advocate EC constitutionalization during the debate about European Union in the 1970s. Thus, it largely shaped the European Parliament's 1975 Bertrand Report. In times of strong intergovernmentalism that saw the informal institutionalization of the European Council in 1974, however, the group put somewhat greater emphasis on two points for which it expected more support from the Commission and the Council: new EC policies to address transnational challenges, like pollution or environmental policy, and increased institutional efficiency to overcome blockages in the Council. Once the EP was directly elected, the EPP group immediately set out to discuss EC reform in the Political Affairs Committee's Institutional Subcommittee, which prepared a number of reports that were eventually debated and adopted in plenary session, but led to nothing. At this point, the Italian MEP and former Commissioner Altiero Spinelli claimed in the European Parliament's plenary that the community is practically paralyzed. He took the initiative and set up the cross-party crocodile club to bring about fundamental constitutional change through creating an ad hoc EP committee to prepare a draft constitution to be ratified by the parliaments of the member states. The Crocodile Club initiative posed a serious challenge for the EPP group in a number of ways. Ideologically, as one of the founding fathers of European federalism, the socialist Spinelli, who had broken with Stalinism in the 1930s, largely shared the EPP group's programmatic preference for constitutionalizing the European communities. Nevertheless, although not a party member, he had actually been elected to the EP on the list of the Italian Eurocommunists, which made it much harder for Christian Democrats to sell cross-party cooperation with him to their staunchly anti-communist members in countries like Germany, including Bavaria, where this was not particularly popular. Politically, Spinelli's initiative also threatened to undermine the EPP group's standalone identity in the European Parliament as the strongest promoter of deepening European integration since 1945. Institutionally, the EPP group feared that its leading role on EC reform could be undermined by changes in the European Parliament's committee structure. In the end, Klepsch overruled the internal dissent in the EPP group so that the EP resolution for European Union was eventually adopted in plenary with full European People's Party group support in 1981. In a diplomatic gesture, it explicitly referred to the EPP group's 1979 resolution on European Union. And from then onwards, the EPP group constituted the backbone of parliamentary support for the Spinelli initiative. Although the final version of the resulting 1984 draft treaty on European Union marked a constitutional compromise and was never ratified, the process leading up to the EP vote on it in the end nevertheless played a crucial role. First, in sustaining the EPP group's leadership role on institutional deepening despite its origins in the Spinelli initiative. Second, in facilitating cross-party consensus on the need for endowing the EP with substantial powers and for overcoming blockages in the Council by stopping the unanimity practice. And third, creating a repertoire of constitutional ideas for reform, which the EPP group, national parties, and EPP-controlled governments could later draw on. Thus, the draft treaty on European Union for the first time legally defined the principle of subsidiarity that later became inserted in the Maastricht Treaty. The EPP group's EC reform activism enhanced its internal cohesion, it incentivized cross-party cooperation, and led it to pressurize national parties and governments to support major change in a broadly federal direction. Thus, the EPP group, I would argue, played a leading role in creating and consolidating a strong trajectory for the further deepening of European integration. The EPP's programmatic demands, as condensed in the electoral platform for the 1979 EP election, enshrined fundamental policy objectives and created vectors that basically shaped EPP group preferences until the 2009 Lisbon Treaty. Alongside institutional reform demands that I've already talked about, these objectives mainly pertain to domestic, in inverted commas, domestic EC affairs. Foreign policy cooperation in the European community was limited and purely intergovernmental, so that the EP could and did discuss global issues, but did not substantially influence policy. As a result, global policy matters remained marginal to the EPP group's work during the Cold War. Regarding domestic EC matters, the 1979 electoral platform was a bland document designed to please all constituencies and to paper over some fundamental differences within and across the EPP group and the EPP member parties, and especially on socio-economic policy. In fact, the EPP group encompassed a significantly broader ideological range on socio-economic issues than the socialists. Its internal programmatic diversity was, and still is more than ever in 2019, down to three main factors. The first of these consisted of the significant differences in the political economy and socio-economic policy traditions of the member states. They ranged from the German social market economy to the Dutch, and I'm just giving some examples here, to the Dutch consociational model of institutionalized consensus seeking and the more statist French system under reform at the moment. The second factor for the EPP Group's internal fragmentation is intra-party politics, especially the relative influence in the national catch-all parties of representatives close to constituencies like farmers, trade unions, or industry. Finally, different and changing coalition preferences constituted the third factor that helps explain the EPP Group's ideological diversity on socio-economic policy issues. In Germany, the CDU-CSU followed a staunchly anti-socialist course during the Cold War. At the opposite end of the spectrum, the Italian DC forged the historic compromise with the Euro-communists in the late 1970s. When the EPP Group as a whole or individual MEP sought to influence legislative policymaking before the EP acquired formal powers in the Single European Act, the Maastricht Treaty, they could basically use three different routes. The first was working with the Commission at the EC level. This concerned, in the first instance, the Christian Democrats who often attended study days or group meetings. Several, including Vinyes, Scaraccia Muñoz, and Hallstein, for example, had experience as MEPs before or after their mandate in the Commission, thus contributing to close ties between the institutions at the political level. Influencing national political parties and governments constituted a second avenue for the EPP Group and individual MEPs to influence EC policymaking. Lastly, the EPP Group and individual MEPs could also appeal to the public to encourage the Commission and Council to act at the EC level. Arguably, the creation, implementation, and protection of the Common Agricultural Policy initially had the greatest strategic importance for the Group after 1958. Embedded in personalist notions of human dignity and healthy rural communities, and based on the interwar experience of many farmers going over to far-right political parties, the Christian Democrats prioritized keeping farmers happy after 1945. Crucially, they constituted a core electoral constituency too, with some 90% of farmers voting for the CDU-CSU in Germany, for example. The Europeanization of agricultural policy was a key building block for the Christian Democrats' strategy for the sector. The CD Group strongly supported the notion of the family farm, not just as an economic, but a social model for the EEC and its member states. A powerful narrative, although the Common Agricultural Policy's funding mechanisms later actually favored large-scale farming and multinational food companies. The structure of the Common Agricultural Policy effectively put farmers on a Europe-wide welfare system. In the 1960s and 1970s, the EPP Group also favored more community spending for other welfare policies. Thus, when Keynesian economics reached its peak in Western Europe at the start of the 1970s, it propagated greater state interventionism, EC-level fiscal mechanisms for regional redistribution, and increased EC-level funding for investment programs designed to strengthen infrastructures, foster growth and employment in backward regions, and to create comparable living conditions, as this was called in the German Basic Law Constitution. Far from being solely a demand by Britain in its accession negotiations, the EPP Group also argued for a powerful European Community regional policy to address regional imbalances. I think it's important to remind ourselves of this in view of all the fundamental changes in economic policy ideology since the 1980s. Despite the ideological differences among the member parties, the EPP Group saw EC-level funding for farmers and rural and old industrial regions in transition, not as a waste of taxpayers' money in those days. To the Christian Democrats at this time, this EC-level expenditure constituted the Europeanization of redistributive policies that were well established at national level in the form of subsidy policies for farmers and regional policies such as the Italian Cassa del Mezzogiorno or the German financial equalization mechanism among the federal states. This was a form of Europeanization, moreover, that they regarded as necessary to counterbalance the effects of economic liberalization in the customs union and as beneficial for enhancing the political legitimacy of the European communities. The Christian Democrats had advocated the creation of a common market from the start of core Europe integration, both for its expected economic benefits and as a stepping stone to greater political integration. The successful completion of the customs union in 1968 was only one building block of such a common market, however. In the early 1960s, the CD Group made a significant contribution to the debate about competition policy as a second building block. The third one was the abolition of non-tariff barriers. Member states sometimes deliberately, sometimes inadvertently used such non-tariff barriers like technical norms and standards to protect domestic producers from foreign competition. Industry circles increasingly lobbied for a more comprehensive approach to complete the internal market, which eventually resulted in the 1987 Single European Act and the Single Market Programme. This process was largely shaped by member states like the United Kingdom, which pushed the liberalization agenda for the EC, the industry lobby, especially the European Roundtable of Industrialists, and the European Commission, especially British Commissioner Caulfield and President Delors, who exploited the political opportunity of connecting the internal market with the EC's institutional reform in the 1987 Single European Act. The EPP group collectively, which was still much more stuck in the Europeanization of Keynesian redistribution, played a supportive but not a decisive role in this process, which was initially mainly backed by liberal conservatives in the European People's Party and its group, and among the British Tories, as well as many in the liberal group in the European Parliament. In 1979, the German CDU MEP Karl von Wogau created the Kangaroo Group, together with a British conservative Basil de Ferranti, one of the EP vice presidents. Naming their group, which initially consisted of MEPs only and later became, and still exists, later became a broader informal forum after the Australian animal for its ability to make huge forward leaps, they wanted to promote the completion of the internal market and progress on monetary cooperation and integration within the EP and beyond. Questions of economic integration in the broadest sense were evidently at the heart of European integration. The EPP group, in line with the EP majority, supported the abolition of capital controls as well as the general objective of monetary union, including the creation of a single currency as its end goal. At the same time, the EPP group also noted how to implement this general objective in practice was highly contested within and across the member states and political parties in times of continuing great divergences of socio-economic preferences and policies during the 70s and early 80s. This was also the reason why the 1984 draft treaty on European Union still only included generalities on the topic. This was a lack of ideological convergence that I would argue has tainted the actual operation of economic and monetary union since the introduction of the euro. This lecture has hopefully provided sufficient evidence for how the EPP group, with its European ambition, succeeded in playing a central role in European Parliament politics and policy making from the creation of the European Coal and Steel Community in the early 1950s through to the EC's transformation into the European Union in the early 1990s. This even at a time after 1975 when it was no longer numerically the largest group. The Christian Democratic Party's early transnational networking and their cooperation in the ECSC's Common Assembly and then in the European Parliament after 1958 created long-term vectors, or what historical institutionalists call path dependencies, which shaped its internal constitution and practices, as well as its ideological orientation and programmatic commitments for a very long time, and in several ways actually beyond the first direct elections. One of the most important structural continuities consisted of the emergence and maintenance of strong ties among Christian Democrats from the six ECSC founding member states. While pragmatic in adverse circumstances like de Gaulle's advocacy of intergovernmentalism during the 1960s, they essentially shared a broadly federalist agenda for the European communities. The second most important structural continuity lay in the weakness of Franco-German ties in the EPP group compared to the great importance of this bilateral engine in the Council, which sometimes stuttered badly and arguably has stuttered badly in the last few years, but was nevertheless indispensable for European integration. In view of the organizational and electoral weakness of Christian democracy in France after 1958, the EPP group was characterized instead by an informal trilateralism of the Italian, German, and Benelux delegations. Then, from the 1970s, the EPP group was increasingly dominated by an Italo-German bilateralism. Both delegations together had an absolute majority of seats. Their effective cooperation gave stability not just to the group, but also to the EC more generally. Alongside these structural continuities, the CDEPP group's European ambitions also created strong long-term vectors for its political and policy preferences. This concerned, most importantly, the group's overriding commitment to the EC's constitutionalization and what I would call the normalization of the European Parliament as a kind of federal-level parliament with full budgetary and legislative powers. The process that led to the drafting of the 1984 draft treaty on European Union made abundantly clear just how important this commitment was, not just for the EPP group's ideological identity and cohesion, but also for its position within the European Parliament. Additionally, the group was also committed from the start of European integration to the creation of a common market with associated policies like competition and monetary cooperation. Economic liberalization that had to be combined with a full or partial Europeanization of redistributive welfare policies, however, especially for agriculture, but also for rural and old industrial regions in the form of structural funds and the new regional policy in the 1970s. While the Christian Democrats' general ideological and policy commitments remained quite stable until the Maastricht Treaty, the EPP group also needed to respond to new and previously unforeseen policy challenges. One of these was monetary integration, which exposed that the Christian Democrats were much more united on general economic policy goals than their actual implementation, which in this case was largely left to the national governments and central banks. A lack of agreement about core objectives of monetary union that was, as in some other policy fields, due to different national experiences and policy traditions. This lack of convergence has come back to haunt not just the EPP group, but also arguably the European Union more generally since the economic and financial crisis. During the 40 years from the creation of the European Coal and Steel Community to the EC's transformation into the EU in the early 1990s, the EPP group was able to influence not just EP politics and policy making, but also the development of the EC in ways that have largely been overlooked in the older political science literature, which was still focused on explaining formal institutions and their powers. What the EP lacked in formal powers, the EPP group and individual MEPs sought to compensate as much as possible through informal mechanisms of networking with the national political parties and parliamentary parties, the Christian Democratic Commissioners and Christian Democrat-led governments, as well as occasionally non-governmental organizations, as in the case of the emergent EC environmental policy. Alongside its growing formal powers to influence the EC budget and later EC legislation, the EPP group and individual MEPs were a source of expertise in fields like competition policy. They were also at the center of strong policy communities, as in agriculture, which was especially dear to the European People's Party group. Moreover, they started to form, or at least to contribute to, advocacy coalitions, whether for the EC's institutional reform or new EC-level solutions to transnational policy challenges. It has hopefully become clear that the EPP group, to varying extents, fulfilled the system-building and policy-making functions. They contributed core ideas to the process of EC constitutionalization in a federal direction, including the normalization of the EP as a federal-level parliament with full budgetary and legislative powers. They also sought to shape opinion formation and policy making not just in the European Parliament, but in the EC system more generally. And they did so quite successfully. Not surprisingly, therefore, when the Cold War ended in 1989-90 and the Soviet Union collapsed in the following year, for the EPP, this momentous change marked a kind of end of history, to quote Francis Fukuyama, although he used that in a different context, of course. Its values of democracy, human rights, social market economy, and European integration appeared to have prevailed for good, not just over communism, but any form of socialism. The resulting enthusiasm for the EPP and EPP group's enlargement and for deepening the EU very quickly based on existing federalist templates, which is understandable retrospectively, nevertheless posed great challenges, and that the alliance of center-right parties did not foresee at the time and that were perhaps not foreseeable. The first of these challenges concerned the EPP's ability to absorb many more new parties during the EU's northern and eastern enlargements. The ambition to socialize new East Central and Southeastern European parties, in particular into the post-war Christian Democratic consensus, proved to be particularly difficult and created internal strife. the conflict with the increasingly nationalistic far-right Hungarian Prime Minister Orbán and his Fidesz party is just the most pertinent example of the growing internal heterogeneity in the EPP group and the European People's Party as a party alliance. The second challenge concerned the increasingly pervasive discourse about the EC's so-called democratic deficit from the 1970s onwards, a discourse that ironically the EPP group had fostered in order to strengthen its claim to more powers for the European Parliament as apparently the only remedy to this fundamental problem. After the end of the Cold War and the Maastricht Treaty, however, populist parties on the right and left of the spectrum increasingly radicalized this democratic deficit discourse to discredit long-standing European People's Party group ambitions for the EU, as well as the entire European project. This up to the point where many European Union member states and societies have become increasingly polarized internally, not just over membership of the EU or further integration, but even the future direction of democracy. The United Kingdom's Brexit saga is merely the most iconic example of this polarization, a polarization that in times of a growing illiberal turn in Europe and external pressures from the likes of Putin, Erdogan and Trump threaten the very existence of the Christian Democrats' post-war project for integration. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Professor Kaiser. And we now have some time for questions, debates, answers, hopefully as well. So please.
If you could tell us a little bit more as to how the Christian Democrats in Germany overcame the issue of confessionalism and were successful in co-opting the Protestant people as well. Thank you.
Can you comment more about the social market economy and the fact that actually the period since 90s, actually, the decrease of the political influence of trade unions that was strongly backwarded by Christian Democrats? Maybe some comments. Does Europe has social-friendly face?
And I want to ask you about the federalization of the European Union. Do you think the European Union can continue in that way with some federal taxes, with the increase of the budget of the European Union, with the transfers to the poor regions and poor countries, and also with the Ministry of Finance of the European Union, or maybe some sort of government of the European Union. Thank you.
Yeah, I will try. I think it's always a nice idea to group some questions together. It also gives me a little bit of time to think about your questions. First of all, your question about the overcoming of the confessional divide in Germany, which was, of course, in institutional terms, a post-war phenomenon with the creation of the Christian Democratic Union and the Christian Social Union as interconfessional political parties. The Center Party was revived and was reasonably successful in regional contexts like the Rhineland and Westphalia, for example. But, of course, overall, this model of the interconfessional party prevailed. And I think one of the reasons for why it prevailed was the historical experience of the late 19th century and the Weimar Republic, and of the division of the Catholic pro-democrats and the Protestant pro-democrats in different political parties and groups, and sometimes their antagonistic political behavior towards each other. And the idea that this had actually weakened parliamentary democracy in the Weimar Republic. So from that perspective, I think it's more a political than a confessional or religious approach to overcome this divide and create a broader center-right political party with a Christian identity. And of course, initially, this was the formal setup. Of course, in practice, initially, political Catholicism was still the strongest influence within the CDU and the CSU particularly as well. In terms of the voters, for example, 60% of the voters for the CDU-CSU were initially Catholic and only 40% Protestants. In fact, it seemed to be necessary to organize the Protestants inside the CDU into the so-called Arbeitskreis, or working group for Protestants within the CDU. And that, I think, reflected the the failed need by Protestants in the CDU to have a stronger voice. I think what is also important is to keep in mind that the traditions of political Catholicism still continue to be very influential in probably quite a positive way in terms of shaping West European reconciliation and integration, because the entire agenda that I've talked about of EC constitutionalization of West European integration was something that was strongly shaped by Catholic politicians within the CDU and CSU, so almost without exception, like Adenauer, Fentano, and I could make a long, create a long list, whereas Protestant members of the political party were somewhat more concerned initially in the early post-war period with the question of unification, which of course also had a confessional dimension because Protestants were a majority in the newly created GDR after 1949. So it was a very complex process that has now been researched really well by historians who have found that the initial institutional setup of an interconfessional political party didn't mean that there was no friction or internal jockeying for positions of these different confessions and associated political groups and support mechanisms. On the second question, the decrease of trade union influence. This is, of course, not just a subject for debate for the Christian Democrats, but more generally. So we have this wider trend of deunionization, which has got all sorts of reasons. One is, of course, primarily the decline of traditional industries and the fact that you have low levels of unionization in the service sector. So this is a more global phenomenon of the decline of trade union organization. But within the trade unions, more generally, we also see a decline of the Catholic or Christian trade union organizations, and this has, I think, had a significant impact on the internal policy making within Christian Democratic or European People's Parties in Northwestern Europe, in the sense that this trade union influence has diminished very significantly, and that in terms of the programmatic orientation of these parties, this has greatly facilitated the economic liberalization agenda. I'm deliberately not using the term neoliberal because I don't think much of it is entirely neoliberal. There's still auto-liberal orientation with a significant emphasis on social policy. But this has become perhaps somewhat lopsided and has created a problem, I think, for these political parties in terms of their appeal to a wider electorate and also in terms of trying to identify programmatic policy preferences for the whole of Europe, and has led to a greater polarization between the richer, economically more advanced countries with low levels of unemployment, again, like in Scandinavia, in Germany, in the Netherlands, etc., and discourses about not wasting taxpayers' money, put it simplistically, on lazy Southern Europeans, and Southern Europeans, on the other hand, who would, of course, quite like to see more such transfers. So this has become much more of an issue compared to the 1970s, which I was talking about. And the last question, which was about the federal direction or federalization of the European Union, the question here, I think, is whether we have had this long debate since the 1970s, in fact, because of these complaints about eurosclerosis and blockages in the Council, inability to take efficient decisions, a long debate that started really with the argument that it is difficult in the late 70s, difficult to make any progress with governments like the British and the Danish government at the time, which were both very averse to further integration, make any progress, and that therefore we need some form of differentiated integration. And we have had this discussion, of course, on and off, and we have differentiated integration in many areas, like border controls, for example, or, of course, economic and monetary union, and so on. So I think that there will be a tendency to say, well, it's obvious that there are some member states with their current governments in the European Union that will absolutely refuse to go in the direction of further integration, at least in certain policy areas, if not because they're perhaps even fundamentally opposed to this on ideological grounds, like the Polish or Hungarian government parties, that therefore we need more differentiated integration and need to allow a smaller core group of countries to forge ahead if they want to. And I think what is interesting there is that despite the somewhat odd Italian case, we still have the old core Europe, in inverted commas, of the founding member states as a relatively cohesive group that you can well imagine might take the lead in making progress, but together with other countries like Spain and others who've joined later on. So I think that is perhaps the only way out in order to avoid antagonizing countries that currently do not want to participate in such forms of further integration, but also at the same time allowing others to make progress.
Okay, thank you very much. I see Professor Babic.
I had two interconnected questions, both referring to the issues of identity, integration, and loyalty. The first one, at the outset, you spoke about the Roman Catholic base of the process of unification at the beginning. And we know that the United Kingdom joined later, and we had the opportunity to hear here in Belgrade that the Swedish ambassador was talking about the reluctance of Sweden to face the Roman Catholic majority in the that was one of their worries. And when we think in broader historical schemes, we may say that the process of integration is having a very long history from Charlemagne, from the times of Karl des Großen. That process was interrupted heavily and decisively in the Reformation, when the scheme of what we call now Westphalia was created, like creating independent national states. And that was the root of a kind of political nationalism, which is actually a kind of obstacle to make a unified political structure of unified Europe.
Within the EPP or Christian Democrats, when it comes to the issue of EU enlargement, not currently, but historically speaking, from the early 70s onwards, or was it always just highly contextual, given different time and the geographies involved in other different political implications? So is there anything that kept them voting or kept them pressing on with this policy, or was it always just a matter of tactical positioning within the given context? Thank you.
Yeah, I still, even if you didn't mean to ask about that, I still want to clarify that point, because I think it's very important that the Catholic Church actually had an ambivalent attitude towards this form of West European integration after 1945. It was broadly supportive in as much as European integration was seen as a kind of anti-communist measure, or a measure that would contain communism or help contain communism. But the Pope at the time, of course, spoke about European integration in far more what he called spiritual terms. So he wanted a spiritual form of unification and not one that was based on social economic integration or market integration. This was actually seen as a liberal approach, 19th century liberal approach, that was alien to the Catholic Church. So I think it's quite important that there were big differences here from the official Vatican's perspective, and this was very different from the political, secular political parties that were steeped in Christian and Catholic party traditions, but did not take commands from the Vatican. I think that's just important to point out, because of course the perception outside in the more Protestant and dominated northern European countries was for a long time that this was somehow directed from Rome, and this was used as a political argument against joining the European communities as late even as the Norwegian referendum about European Union membership in 1994. It was just a residual argument. Then in the early 70s in the referendums, it was still a significant argument in the political debates in the UK and Denmark, for example, and later in Sweden as well. So I'm talking about the political preferences that are informed by particular forms of Catholic social teaching, for example, like this notion of subsidiarity and so on, which bottom-up organization of society, which is also quite easily compatible with federalist political visions of the European Union as kind of, you know, what political scientists call multi-level governance. These kinds of influences, I think, were strong via the EPP, and the EPP managed to diffuse that also to other, to some extent, to other political groups. And it's interesting to see that a federalist, a socialist federalist like Spinelli, on these points could very largely agree with EPP positions. The more narrowly Catholic visions of European integration were prominent really only in the first, I would say, 10 years of the post-war period. And they were largely, or developed largely in the context of discussions about Occidental culture, or the Abendland discourse, which was very strong in Germany, and much less strong in other countries of continental Western Europe. And this was really in the conservative, among conservative Catholics within the CDU-CSU was relatively prominent, included politicians like von Brentano, for example, foreign minister of Germany after 1955, and parliamentary party leader for a short time after 61. So that, however, petered out, and I think this particular definition of or legitimation of European integration after that was really not particularly significant or influential. On your second question regarding the question of loyalty transfer, I don't know whether this is a particular Serbian or Southeastern European context. Of course, you've had a very different contemporary history from that of Northwestern European countries. And I think against that background, I would understand if you were to say that loyalty and like identity can only be at one level, in this case at the national level or the former Yugoslav level or some other such level, maybe the local level. I would say that there is an understanding academically, I'm sure you're aware of that now, that multiple identities and therefore also multiple loyalties are quite possible and are not necessarily incompatible.
The hierarchy of loyalty still is
The level?
The hierarchy of loyalty.
The hierarchy, yes, you're absolutely right. I think there are very good opinion polls on the question of whether you think you have a European identity as well as a national or possibly a subnational identity and how to what extent that matters. And there are huge differences across the European Union member states. As far as I know, by far the highest percentage of people who say that their primary identity is a European one are not Germans but Luxembourgers, perhaps for good reasons, about 25% or so, who say that's our primary identity, not the only one, of course. And everywhere else, it's somewhere between 6, 7, 8, 15, 16% or so. Relatively low, but it's nevertheless not insignificant because these tend to be people who belong to the inverted commas transnational elites in business or in education. It could be students who participate in Erasmus programs, etc., or in fact in transnational forms of politics. So these people tend to be transnationally well connected and feel at home in this larger, more integrated Europe, not just in their own place where they come from or their nation. So Germany is not actually, unlike what you might expect, perhaps because of its historical experience, out of line with the sort of general patterns in the European Union. What may make it easier, and that's why I would agree with you, is if you are talking about a member state that is internally, relatively, culturally, or linguistically fragmented and has a federal or decentralized form of political constitution with strong regions. In that case, it is always easier to develop this European identity as one that is seen as compatible with the national and the subnational identities. But Germany is a very good example, for that is not the only example. For example, if you go to Scotland, you find that two-thirds of the people in Scotland think it's really lovely to be in the European Union. They don't want to leave, and they think it's completely compatible with their Scottish national or regional, however you want to define it, identity. And Catalonia is a similar case in point. So I think if you have this kind of decentralized political structure as in the UK or in Spain or federal political structure as in Germany, the compatibility of these different identity levels and levels of loyalty or points of orientation of loyalty, I think can be brought together more easily than if you have an exclusive small state national identity, and I'm not talking about Serbia, but a country like Denmark, for example, which has very strong small state nationalism, and then it's far more difficult to develop this European level identity and see it as compatible with that. On the question of EU enlargement, what I find striking is that the European People's Party never had a single person or group of persons who you could describe as Vordenker regarding enlargement, you know, people who would have some kind of advanced vision of what kind of impact enlargement of the group or the People's Party might have, how it might transform the group itself and possibly make it more heterogeneous, etc., how to create greater convergence. So a large part of this process was very heavily instrumental and functional in the sense that the People's Party simply wanted to be the strongest party group in the European Union and also the strongest group again in the European Parliament, which of course it managed to do eventually when it became the largest group in the 1999 European Parliament elections. When you look at individual cases like Poland, etc., and other countries in Eastern Europe particularly, where the party systems were initially very fluid, these actors, including the German Foundation, were relatively flexible in terms of jumping ship and also moving to a different political party and supporting a different political party if they thought that it was gaining ground internally, with a view to strengthening the EPP's political power and influence. So I think the fundamental problem, and I believe that many people see it this way as well, having spoken to former presidents of the group in the parliament, like Hans-Gerd Pöttering, or the current Secretary General of the EPP group in the parliament, they're fully aware that this has created great internal problems of heterogeneity, ideological heterogeneity, views about the desirability of further integration, which widely diverse and are very diverse and diverge very widely. And of course, Orbán is only the most prominent example of this. And I don't think anyone really seriously discussed how this process might develop at any point in time. And the reason for that is really this historically completely understandable massive enthusiasm around 1989-1990 for European unification, in inverted commas, which was obviously these countries in Central and Southeastern Europe had rejected socialism of any kind from the EPP's perspective, you know, not just communism but socialism, and wanted all of the things that the European People's Party was standing for. And it seemed like that in the European Parliament as well. I remember, for example, during my stage or internship with the European Commission, I think it was 1991, I went to the European Parliament for Wałęsa's speech to the European Parliament. And Wałęsa was very sharply attacked by the French socialist leader of the socialist group at the time. So, you know, what do you want in Europe? You have to go through this learning process for the next 10, 20, 30 years. We don't really want you here. We don't need you. Because the socialists were terribly afraid that socialism had completely collapsed and they would have no support politically in Eastern Europe. So this was replicated on the other side of the political spectrum. So the EPP and the EPP member parties felt this is a fantastic historic opportunity for the unification of Europe and our dominant hegemonic position in this future, larger integrated Europe. And they didn't really think about all of the problems that could emerge in the course of this process at all.
I wanted to give you a small present, actually, after our socializing, because our formal working party is kind of finished. We just made, with colleague Stefan, one small sightseeing here. I hope we'll continue in the afternoon. But this is a small memory, Belgrade, the eternal city. Well, you know, we are just like a Rome. We were joking upon that, you know, modestly. I hope that this book, which is in English, hopefully, will help you to get more about the history and some interesting stories and so on. So thank you. I wanted to just give you a small memory on our socializing these days. And at the
thank
end,
you very much.
You're more than welcome. And finishing with we didn't touch upon European elections today. Okay, if you want, just give some overview. I think that it might be very interesting to people. I know that journalists have already asked quite a lot upon of that. And the other two issues, actually, to put it to the one, yesterday we had also a very nice debate after the lecture in Matica in Novi Sad. And in just briefly, out of, let me say, three things that were characterizing Christian democracy at the beginning, Professor Kazin insisted actually that at this moment, let me say, federalization or preserving European project is basically dominating over other things that were characteristic in the beginning. But I just wanted to ask you if anything has remained of these other two things. One is, of course, this social conservatism, let me say, or that was connected with the political Catholicism, let me say, the system of values which they shared and which was pretty radically conservative and important for them after the, at least in the first 10 or 15 years after the beginning of that. I mean, the family values, this discourse on farms as a healthy environment and so on, and it seems that it's completely evaporated somehow from the EPP generally and what is Christian democracy. So now, a general joke we mentioned, like it's neither Christian, neither democracy, somehow with a little bit exaggeration. But is it remained at least in some way within some factions within EPP, or is it maybe something that radicalists or populists are trying to take over somehow? And the other issue, and I would like really to finish with that, because it's, I think, very important for Serbs here, and is the whole idea of social market economy. As I told you, generally what we perceive here as Western models, or this binner dimension of either you're a socialist or even Keynesianism is perceived, unfortunately, as some kind of socialism, either very strong libertarianism and so on. So the model of the social market economy with ordoliberalism, with the rule of law and so on, in which sense it has survived as a German or European project, and how alive is it today, and could it be preserved for the future as well? Sorry for putting more things in your finishing.
How many hours do I have for the answer? On the second question, I would say that there's still residual elements, of course, in party programs, but I don't see that this social Catholic tradition is really in any way vibrant in any of the parties that we are talking about. And so I think you are right on the point that populist political parties are trying to take on this agenda to some extent. Of course, they do this in a particular form that also distorts these traditional values in some way, but they try to occupy more conservative social and family values for themselves and their own political agenda. Also, the European People's Party and its member parties, of course, are confronted with this continuing social and economic crisis. There are issues even in rich countries like Germany or the United Kingdom or elsewhere, which have low unemployment, but where there's a certain divergence in terms of income and wealth, etc., in the societies, and there are concrete social problems like housing, affordable housing, for example, which is a bigger and bigger problem also in Germany and bigger wealthy cities, but not just there. And they don't really have the ideological or value-based instruments in order to address these kinds of issues anymore. And I think it will be interesting to see to what extent they can go back to these traditions that were much more vibrant in the post-war period without pressures like from the Christian trade unions, which are really quite marginal, as we've discussed, in order to find appropriate responses, not just at the regional and national, but also at the European level. Because this debate is so much dominated by the question of whether fiscal transfers of one form or another make any sense, whether they're efficient or not, etc. And this is no longer really embedded, this discussion, in some kind of firmer value base. On the social market economy, I think the basic idea which Erhard had in early post-war West Germany, the basic idea that he had was that he was taking a kind of ordo-liberal, liberal essentially, but ordo-liberal approach to regulating the economy and endowing it with some social policy mechanisms in order to compensate and to help individuals who through no fault of their own did not manage to succeed personally in this liberal economic environment, that this basic idea is still one that is very strong. That, of course, if you want to look at this seriously as a historian, you have to say Erhard's vision was, of course, already to a large extent changed by the practice of the West German governments, for example, with the huge expansion in the late 1950s of the welfare model for the provision of pensions. This is not what Erhard initially had in mind. But this basic principle, which of course is now enshrined also in the Lisbon Treaty, interestingly, which was still difficult in the 70s for the EPP to agree on, because parties like the Italian party and the Belgian party thought it was too liberal and not sufficiently social enough in its orientation, definitely has, I think, potential for combining processes of globalization, liberalization within Europe with the creation of some form of European collective response to the social challenges that are related to these processes. On the third point, the European Parliament elections, well, I would say yes, I thought the European People's Party had lost 41 seats, but in any case they had 180, I think. That's 24% or so of the seats in the European Parliament.
165, and it was 221.
Well, that's a projection.
But at the end of the elections, not
it
before.
Was on Sunday. Not I think before. The end result was 180. But in any case, so the EPP and the Social Democrats have lost significant support.
Yes.
That was predicted. What I think was not predicted was that the populist right-wing parties didn't do as well as they had hoped. They did do really well in Poland and Hungary and Italy, in line with expectations or even a little bit above, like in Poland. But in several other countries, they actually did far worse than they expected. So the AfD in Germany did significantly worse. The Platform for Freedom, I think it's called, in the Netherlands did far worse. The Danish People's Party did far worse. And more generally, I think in Northern Europe, there is a fear among widespread fear in population that this kind of fascist style of someone like Salvini, which I think in terms of the style is outright fascist, is not something that they actually want for their own countries. So you see also, when you look across the populist party spectrum, there are huge differences, both in terms of the programmatic orientation, but also in terms of the style of politics, which is not easily compatible across this whole European Union. And the more they gain in votes, the more these incompatibilities will become apparent again, also to voters who might get frightened about some of these parties' orientations or traditions. So they've actually done less well, and instead what was not predicted was that, to this extent, was that the Liberals, not just because of the UK and the French case, but mainly because of those two countries, did really well and increased their seats by 40, I think, or so. And the Greens in Northern, Northwestern Europe, of course, have done really well. If you keep in mind that they have no representation, with the exception of Austria and Central or East Central or Southeast Eastern or Southern Europe at all, mm-hmm. but it's limited entirely to Northwestern Europe. That's quite significant. So if you take these four groups together, they have only together lost only about 20 seats. So it's not such a huge major sea change, certainly not what some of these more populist leaders expected or demanded from the elections. And what we already see is that also, and thanks in part to Brexit, I think, that there is a greater reluctance to advocate breaking up the European Union or leaving the European Union. Le Pen started this in France, originally coming from the position of leaving the European Union, now says, no, we are not leaving, we need to change the European Union. And this is, in a sense, a return of populist parties to the positions they had in the Cold War period. In the 1980s, the father of Le Pen, as Front National leader, and the Italian neo-fascist, for example, were supportive of European integration. They were supportive, we have to keep in mind, of course, why were they supportive? Because they thought that the European communities could fulfill some functional needs from their perspective as right-wing populist political parties, such as, of course, providing a bulwark against the Soviet Union in times of the Cold War, but also creating a regulated form of migration or inward migration or coordination on getting rid of illegal migrants. So if and when the European Union is seen as fulfilling such expectations more efficiently than now, and we're perhaps on the way to that, it's possible that these populist parties might actually take a stake in the European Union and say, well, this is something that we can't do alone as Italians, for example, but it's actually good that we have the European Union to deal with issues like that. So these things, I think, are much more fluid. If you take a more long-term historical perspective, you see that there is not necessarily a fundamental opposition of necessity between these political parties and the European Union as an organization.
Thank you very much. And this is where we could end up. So, Susanna, finish and.
No.
It's up to you. You know, ladies. Edgar.
No, I just want to thank you again for your really inspiring lecture and the facts that you presented us about the historical overview of the Christian Democrats, etc. And I was commenting a lot the results of the European election and a few more people as well. The biggest achievement is that if you look the composition of the parliament of 751 MEPs, 520 of them are pro-EU. So there is a clear answer to all of those who predicted the victory of Salvinian likes in the EU. So we can be really pleased that 52 MEPs will continue to support the further development and the creation of a hopefully larger and more democratic European Union. Misha just reminded me to mention that we will have a conference here on the 13th of June dedicated to the results of the European elections or the elections for the European Parliament. And by then, some things will be more clear than they are today. So some seats will be taken in the parliamentary structure and probably in some other bodies of the European Union. And we can and we could comment on the trends and the consequences of the elections and the possible impact to the Western Balkans, as usual.
Thank you very much.